So in North America, the standard cinema frame rate is 24 frames per second. That's how you get that nice motion blur that looks really cinematic. But what if we go slower? Now, what if we go slower than that? Now let's go even slower. So how exactly did I get a Pocket 4K to record 4K at 120 frames per second? Hey guys, Nathan here. Now as goofy as the intro was, there's a lot more use to this than just being able to go super slow. You can retime clips to fit your edit better, you can make clips go slower than they should be able to go, and get that much closer to the ultimate goal of the only thing limiting you is your own creativity. So today we're talking all about slow motion in DaVinci Resolve using frame blending and optical flow and the speed warp feature to extend shots longer than they were ever intended to be. But before we get into that, be sure to hit the like button down there and get subscribed for lots more videos like this. Anyway, let's get into it. So here we are in DaVinci Resolve, and as I said earlier, I recorded these shots on a Blackmagic Pocket 4K at 60 frames a second, then output to 23.98 frames per second. If your clips are not converted to your desired frame rate automatically within the camera, an easy way to adjust that is we just go into the media pool, we can grab a couple clips, right click, go into clip attributes, and then right here, video frame rate, adjust that to whatever your desired timeline frame rate is, and bing bang boom, you're off to the races. I will note in this tutorial, we're not talking about speed ramps or any of that fun stuff. That's its own whole video that maybe I'll do later in the future. So if we want to adjust the speed of this clip, there's a whole bunch of different ways we can do it. We can right click, go into change clip speed, and then reduce that to whatever we want. I think going from 60 to 120 frames per second is pretty cool. So we'll take that, change that to 50, and easy peasy. But I personally like to go in, we're going to right click here, click retime controls. Now we can zoom into this sucker a little bit. Now you see this speed, you go into this arrow here, we can now just drag it out to around 50%. And boom, that's also a super easy way to do it. And if you want, you can also just hit Control R to hide and show the retime controls. So now by default, if you haven't changed anything in your project settings, you'll know it plays back super stuttery. It's using the nearest frame option, so it's literally just hanging on each frame for two frames. So bop, 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 bop. That's why it looks super stuttery, because it's technically playing back at like 12 frames per second when it should be paying back at closer to 24. So we can adjust that in our project settings. We're gonna go down to this little icon over here. In the master settings, scroll all the way down to the bottom and we see frame interpolation. Now you have some options for your retime process, your motion estimation, and your motion range. So the nearest, it literally just duplicates frames for making things longer or loses frames for making things shorter. And then you have frame blend, which looks at one frame and the frame next to it and kind of blends the two together to make a new frame in the middle. And then we also have optical flow, which uses AI to look at both of those frames. So it looks at those two frames and then creates a new frame to go in between it based on that information. Obviously, that is the most processor intensive of the options. And then you also have your motion estimation mode, which is pretty straightforward. You got your standard faster, standard better, again, more processing power, enhanced faster, enhanced better. As these increase, they're gonna do a better job with less artifacts, but it's gonna be harder on your computer. But there's one more option they don't show you in here. So if you wanna have a default, we can definitely do that. We're just gonna go with optical flow, standard, faster as our kind of default. We're then gonna go back into the clip and see how this looks. So it looks pretty good, but we're noticing a couple spots there. Do you kind of see that? It's got like this force field around it. It's kind of funky looking. So let's just click on optical flow and then go into, let's say, enhanced better. Now, we see that force field has definitely been reduced, but there is still a little bit of blurring around the edges, and that's when the speed warp feature is super handy. Now, this is a super processor intensive feature, which you cannot apply as your default in your project settings, but if you go into speed warp, look, those artifacts are completely gone. But if I try to play it, I mean, we're getting potato speeds up here. What's that, 2.5 frames a second? I have a pretty good computer, but realistically, where technology is right now, there's a good chance you're not going to get real-time playback with speed warp enabled, which is fine. You can just go through frame by frame, check and see how things look, and then if you need to review your footage, just take it back to your project settings, just knowing that at the end you will change it back to speed warp before you render. So that's all fine and dandy if you want to go mega slow, but what about your more everyday situations? Well, check this out. So here we have these two shots. It's the shot of this dish and then to a cross. Now, let's say we're cutting this together for a music video. Now, we want to keep our motion going in the same direction. So we have this clip here, it's moving left and then going into the cross clip, which is also again moving in the left direction. But maybe this clip isn't quite long enough. We want to extend it a little bit. Well, if we go in this direction, we notice that the camera doesn't actually start moving left. So we'll get rid of that. What if we go in the other direction? Let's see, play it back, and we'll notice that the camera stops. So that's a no bueno. What are we gonna do? Well, that's when our retiming comes in handy. So we're gonna zoom in, and I'm gonna hit Control R to get my retime controls. Gonna zoom in a little bit more and drag on this arrow here. Let's get it to about 50% or so. And we can check our metadata to see this original clip was shot at 23.98. So now we're taking it to about 48 frames a second. So if we play that based on the project settings, which we had set to optical flow and standard faster, you'll see we get this, which in my opinion, totally works. And now we have a longer shot that goes right into our shot with the cross. And just for kicks, let's see if the frame blending option actually works. Hey, I don't know if that works. It definitely makes it pretty blurry, but optical flow at the standard faster settings totally works for this situation. There's not a ton of detail going on, and it's kind of a really creamy shot. So there are some situations where it can totally work out. And be sure to play with the different options so you can find the right settings to fit your particular footage. So then in a shot that you'd expect to be easy, we have this shot that's moving super slow. It was shot at 60 frames a second and output at 23.98. And it's just a panning shot of this nice landscape with all these trees in front. So if we go into our inspector and let's say we want to slow this thing down. So again, we hit Control R and let's bring it out to again, roughly around 50%. I'm just randomly picking 50%. It's whatever fits your particular situation. So we're going to go in and that's set at optical flow. And I'm just going to go full screen. So it may not show through YouTube's compression, but we're definitely getting this weird wavy kind of heat wave effect going on in the trees, because even though it's a very slow moving shot, there's a lot of detail going on in these trees. So in this particular situation, even at enhanced better, if we then go into full screen again, I find you still get that wavy effect. But if you use the all powerful speed warp, I find it works. Can't show you in real time, but I did render a version out. We're gonna go to full screen. And now if we look at these trees, there's no more of that weird line effect going on. So that's definitely something to watch out for. Even though the shot's not moving fast, those high detail areas are really gonna trip it up. So then what if you're dealing with one of the toughest situations, which is high detail, a human face, and one of the things that people are best at recognizing when there's something not quite right with is a human face. So we have this shot here. Let's just play it back. Boom, we have a reaction and a big eye blink. So now let's say we need to make this particular shot longer. Now I just have this shot where I brought it to 50%, set optical flow and standard faster, and you'll see we get this weird ghosting going on. So that's not quite working. And I even rendered a version out with speed warp, and we'll look at it again. And you still see a weird kind of ghosting going on. So let's just think about how optical flow works. It takes one frame and then the frame next to it. If you're stretching it out to where it needs to put a frame in between to hit your desired frame rate, all it has for information is those two frames. So if there's a lot of movement going on and a lot of motion blur in particular in those frames, it's gonna have difficulty knowing exactly what's going on. So what if we reduce the motion blur? Well, an easy way to do that is to increase your shutter speed or bring down your shutter angle. So for example, typically our shutter speed is double the whatever our frame rate is. For example, if you're shooting at 24 frames a second, your shutter speed is 1/48 in most cases, or a shutter angle of 180 degrees. So let's just double that. We'll go with a shutter speed of 1/96 or a shutter angle of 90 degrees. We get something like this. So because your shutter isn't open as long, of course, things will be darker, but here's kind of a side-by-side. We have the normal motion blur and then the 90 degree shutter angle, which I've corrected to kind of look similar. So if we go with the normal motion blur, you can see when I'm kind of blinking my eyes, there's definitely a lot of blur going on there. But if we go to the 90 degree shutter angle shot and you see when I'm closing my eyes, things are definitely much sharper. So it gives it better information to go by. If we, again, use optical flow and let's just set it to standard faster, let's see what we're looking at here. Okay, we're definitely getting that ghosting. But if we're able to use speed warp, you'll see it's done a very good job. So in some cases, if you know you'll have to slow things down after the fact and you have the light for it, it may be your best bet to crank up that shutter speed a little bit to get very crisp frames for optical flow to go off of. Now, I'm not saying do it in every situation, but it could certainly save your bacon in certain circumstances. So anyway, folks, I hope that helps you learn a little bit more about the retiming features in DaVinci Resolve and teaches you ways that you can use them in your own projects. So if you like this video, be sure to hit that like button down there and get subscribed for lots more videos like this. It really does mean a lot to me. And just as a fun stat, like 86% of the people who watch these videos are not subscribed to the channel. So maybe hit that subscribe button. It does help me out a lot. Anyway, have yourself a good one. Okay, bye.